next speaker, Liesbeth Augustinus from Leuven.
Thank you. I will be talking about a topic that is probably very familiar to some of the people in the audience, namely word order variation in Dutch and German verb clusters. For those of you who are not familiar with those phenomena, no worries, I will first give an introduction to the data. Then I'll provide an HPG analysis of verb clusters. I know that several of the LFG people also work on this topic, but I'm not very familiar with LFG, so I didn't include it in my presentation, but maybe we can discuss this afterwards. Then I will illustrate how my analysis of verb clusters actually also accounts for a more straightforward, I think, account of word order variation in those verb clusters. And then I'll come to some conclusions. So let's get started. What is cluster formation in Dutch and German? So in Dutch, we can see constructions like dat hij dat boek moet hebben gevonden, where all verbs occur at the end of the clause, whereas the nominal arguments occur more to the left. And in German we have a similar phenomenon, for instance, dass er das Buch finden können wird. Here also the verbs cluster at the end of the clause, but there are some differences. For instance, the order of selection of the verbs in Dutch is canonically ascending, so moet selects hebben and hebben selects gevonden, and the order of selection is typically indicated by those indices. And in German, it's the other way around. So, wird selects können, können selects finden. So, there are some similarities, some differences. It is characteristic for Dutch and German. Also, Afrikaans and Frisian show cluster formation, but English, for instance, doesn't have it in a similar way. Why are other reasons that those constructions are so interesting? Yes, there are several of them. So another phenomenon is typically linked to cluster formation is the occurrence of the IPP effect, also known as Ersatzinfinitiv in German. So normally a verb of the perfect selects a past participle, but what we see here in those clusters, so has typically selects a past participle, but here the verb appears in the infinitive if it selects another verb. The same happens, so had selects können, and here we see also the appearance of an infinitive, and in those constructions a participle isn't even allowed. Sometimes it is optional, sometimes it's obligatory, and for some verbs it doesn't happen. And then a third reason, which is the main topic of today, that those constructions are so fascinating for linguists, is that verb clusters show a type of word order variation that does not entail a change in meaning. So we can have constructions as dat hij dat boek moet hebben gevonden, so where the canonical word order appears, but the past participle can also appear more to the front of the verb cluster, and in those cases there is no change of meaning, so all those sentences have the same meaning. Also in German this phenomenon occurs, so you can say dass er das Buch finden können wird. But the finite verb in this case can also occur at the front of the verb cluster, and for some people, so it's I think more colloquial German, it may also appear in the middle of the construction. German has a case system, so in general it has, I think, a more flexible word order compared to Dutch, but especially in Dutch it's very characteristic for cluster formation, because if you have, for instance, word order variation in the nominal domain, typically the meaning of the sentence changes. So, ik zei dat de hond de kat achtervolgde, I saw that the dog changed the cat, means the opposite of excited of the dog after pulling at all that the cat chased the dog. So plenty of reasons why those constructions are so interesting. So in sum, with respect to the data, Dutch and German both show cluster formation, the IPP effect and word order variation in clusters, but there are some differences. So the canonical word order is ascending in Dutch but descending in German. Also with respect to the word order variation that is possible, there are some differences. So in Dutch it's mainly the past participle that can occur in different places, whereas in German it's the finite verb. And also I think there are some differences with the set of clustering verbs, so the verbs that select another verb in the cluster. So now I've come to the second part of this presentation, namely the analysis of verb clusters. So typically an HPHD model of verb clusters aims to link the verbs to their non-verbal arguments. Ideally takes into account at least the most frequent types of word order variation, and I will be using an analysis that uses binary branching trees. But first, let's do a bit of history. So the most common analysis of cluster formation in Dutch and German built on the proposal of Hilvis Nakazawa, the generalized reasoning approach. I'll try to sketch the general idea. So here in the construction, das Ulrich dieses Buch lesen können wird. So here you see the verb lesen. It looks for a subject and a direct object, but it's not saturated here. It's first selected by können. So lesen appears on the subcategorization list of können, but not only the infinitival complement, but also the nominal arguments are shared with the selecting verb before they are passed on to the mother node. Same applies to wird. So here it selects the verb, its verbal complement, but also the unsaturated nominal arguments. And here they are attached in the regular head complement way. So this is a very popular analysis, so many people were inspired by this, and it's also applied to Dutch. So here we see the similar analysis, but for Dutch, usually the subject and the complement list, so the subcategorization list is split into the subject and the complement list, but the idea is the same. So in this case, Vinden selects is looking for a nominal subject and direct object, but it's not saturated here. It's selected by Kunnen, and again the unsaturated arguments are passed up via the selecting verbs before they're actually attached to the nominal arguments. This is typically modeled in by means of a lexical constraint. So the argument inheritance or generalized reason constraint. So it's the argument structure list of the selecting verb. So here you see it doesn't only include the verbal complements, but also the subject and the complements of its verbal complement. And it's called generalized reason because if the complement list would be the empty list, you get the constraint that is used for subject raising in HPHD. This looks a very appealing approach, but as Frank van Einde and I showed at previous conferences, this is problematic, at least for Dutch. I'm not going in the details now, but it has to do, for instance, with the passive lexical rule and the binding principles. So we try to come up with a solution, which is the complement raising analysis. And what happens basically is instead that, so you see here that the subject list is shared with the selecting verb, but instead of sharing the complement list as well, only the verbal complement is added to the complement list of the selecting verb, and the unsaturated complement is immediately shared with the complement list of the molar node. This can be done by a phrasal constraint, so the complement raising principle. As this is a phrasal constraint and not a lexical constraint, it's quite powerful, but there are some restrictions on it. So it's, for instance, not applicable in the initial PPs, the initial VPs, and CPs. But it can be used to model verb clusters. And yeah, the result is thus that the complement list can shrink and expand at the same time if it is combined with a regular head complement rule. So I'm using the head complement rule that was also proposed in Stefan Müller's work. So the one where the complements are attached one at a time, so in the binary branching approach. Then, let's have a look at the main topic of this presentation. How can we deal with word for order variation in clusters? Because the analysis only, as so far, has dealt with the canonical word order. So, to quickly go back to the data, so in the introduction I mentioned that Dutch word order is typically ascending, so selection from left to right, whereas in German it is the other way around. But there is some variation in linear order, in Dutch mainly with respect to the past participle, and in German with respect to the position of the finite verb. And in previous accounts, for instance the one of Kato, Palma and Van Noort, this is done by means of the governor feature, which is a kind of extension of the flip feature of that can be found in Hinrichs Nagasawa approach. And I will also use that feature, but in a slightly different way. So the governor feature indicates the direction of the selector. So it is a head feature, so it is shared with the model by means of the head feature principle, and it can have two values. If the selecting verb appears to the left, then it gets this arrow pointing to the left, and if it appears on the right, it gets this arrow to the right. So it's pretty straightforward. And with respect to Dutch, we saw there's a little variation in the order. With respect to the infinitival complements, their selector always appears to the left, so they get this arrow pointing to the left as their governor feature, whereas past participles, they can have their selector to the left and or to the right, so they have this underspecified feature for governor. In an example, it would look like this. So for the canonical cases, we see here moet hebben gevonden, so must have found with the past participle. So past participles are underspecified, but then in this case, it is selected by hebben to the left, so it's it has its pointer to the right. Hebben is the head of this phrase, so it shares its governor feature with the mother node, and the selector moet appears to the left as well, so this looks okay. And in fact, I don't only use the governor feature to model word order in verb clusters, but also to model word order with the rest of the arguments in the clause. And I assume that the complementizer earlier in the sentence selects the finite verb moet, hence this pointer to the left, but you could do that differently, I guess. And then, yeah, a similar thing applies to the infinitival complement lesen. This always has a pointer to the left because it's an, it's an infinitive, and so the same structure applies than one with the past participle, but the construction with the past participle, so can also be moet gevonden hebben, where the past participle occurs to the left of its selector, and then in this case it is so contextually resolved as a pointer to the right. And again, heaven is the head of the of this phrase, so it shares its governor feature with the mother node, which then has to appear to the left. So also this construction is dealt with. If we would have an infinitive here, that would be ruled out because they always have a governor feature pointing to the left, so that would be ungrammatical here. So I think that is what we want. And something similar can be done for German, so in most constructions, and that assumes we will have a problem here. I'll come back to that later. So typically infinitival complements are selected by the verb occurring to the left, so they have this pointer to the right. I'm sorry, so they have this pointer to the right, and this is also the case for past participles. So they are not as flexible as in Dutch. So the canonical cases are dealt with in a similar way. So it's in fact the mirror image of the Dutch constructions. So here. The governor of Finland, or the selecting verb, appears on the right. This is the head of the phrase, so it's shared with the mother node. And then weird appears to its right, and that is again selected by the complementizer. So that's how those constructions are dealt with. And then a similar thing happens to the one with the past participle. So but in contrast to Dutch, as far as I know, but maybe native speakers can help me with this, there's no equivalent to the Dutch 1-3-2 word order where past participle occurs more in the middle of to the front of the verb cluster. And this is ruled out because all German past participle have this feature for governor. Then there is a complication. So as I mentioned earlier, most infinitival complements in German have this pointer to the right, but we do find constructions with auxiliary flip, also known as the Oberfeldumstellung. Dutch has it as well. I can, for instance, say it, but people in the Netherlands think it's odd. So where we can have the finite verb at the end of the cluster, but in German it's more common and in some cases even obligatory. So it seems that defining this governor feature pointing to the right for the German infinitives and to the left for the Dutch infinitives is too strict. But then on the other hand, if you would underspecify it, like for instance as Kato does it, it would highly overgenerate. I try to come up with a solution, and that is to make different categories for the German and Dutch verbs. So I split them up in a set of clustering verbs, and those are the verbs that can select another verb in the cluster. So for the German examples, it's wird and können, and for the Dutch example, it's können and has. So basically all verbs that can appear in the non-final version, so that are not the main verbs in the cluster. They have special properties in that they can, in some cases, select their complements in the Dutch construction to the right and in the German construction on the left. So, and then you can say that non-clustering verbs, in the case of German, all have this governor feature pointing to the right, but are underspecified for the set of clustering verbs, and then for Dutch it's then the other way around, at least for the varieties that allow it. And in this case you can account for the variation. So for instance, finden können wird, or wird finden können, if you allow that canon is underspecified for the governor feature. And then the cases in where it is obligatory, for instance the IPP constructions in German, you can specify this in the lexical entries, as it is, I think, usually done. And also because it's like a limited set of verbs that allow it. But then, the constructions in Dutch that allow it can be done in a similar way. But these are quite colloquial. But then there is a final construction that actually raises some problems for binary branching analysis. And those are the 3-1-2 constructions. So the Dutch gevonden moet hebben, where the past participle occurs as a first element in the clause, and the German constructions, like for instance, finden wird können, where the finite verb occurs in the middle of the cluster. So, in fact, where the main verb is not adjacent to its selector. So here, hebben selects gewonnen and können selects finden, but they're not adjacent. Those constructions are also known by the elegant German tongue twister Zwischenstellung, something like that. So in between construction, I think. Those are problematic for those binary branching approaches because the selecting verb doesn't occur next to its selector. How are they typically dealt with? Baume and van Oort, for instance, assume a flat tree structure for the verb clusters. So then you don't have this problem because you can allow more options with respect to the word order in the cluster. So that's positive, but then the downside is that they need quite a lot of additional machinery in order to avoid overgeneration. Cattle approaches the problem in a different way. He uses the domain feature to model the linear order, and then you can allow for more shuffling of the elements. But then the downside is that you sort of lose the surface-oriented analysis that's rather typical for HPHD. But I can imagine, like, because the word order in German in general is maybe more flexible because of this case system, I don't really like this approach for Dutch, because in general our word order is quite more restricted. But I think in the analysis of cluster formation, so the alternative complement raising approach, those constructions do not really pose a problem. So in my dissertation, I proposed the analysis of Dutch 3-1-2 constructions as another instance of complement raising. This is possible because the complements of the selected verb are no longer shared by the selector. So here you see that heaven selects a verbal complement, gevonden, but this complement is not shared by the selecting verb moet. Only the infinitival complement hebben is shared. Subject raising is still done in a similar way, so this is shared, and also the governor feature of hebben, so hebben has this pointer to the left, selected by moet. Moet is, is selected by the complementizer, so also has this pointer. This is shared with the molar node, as well as the subject list, and then the complement list is directly shared between heaven and also the nom head and the molar node. And then in this case, the complement gevonden is attached here, so it disappears from the complement list. So this is actually another instance of complement raising, and because it is a past participle, it can be selected on the right. So the complement raising analysis allows for this type of constructions without many additional mechanisms, I think. And it also avoids overgeneration, because only past participles may occur to the left of their selector. Constructions of the type lezen zal kunnen, where an infinitive occurs in the first position, they are correctly ruled out because they have this arrow pointed to the left as a governor feature. So this is what we want. And then I think this analysis can also be extended to German. But in this case, yeah, it's slightly more complicated because in this case we have actually a combination of the auxiliary flip combined with complement raising. So here, the finite verb wird occurs to the left of können. So this is the instance of the auxiliary flip, but then the rest is similar to the Dutch construction. So können has finden as its infinitival complement, but it is only attached higher in the window. So via complement raising, this cons value is shared with another node, and then here combined with the infinitival complement. So those, I think, are the most common types of word order variation that occur in Dutch and German. I hope it wasn't too much of a construction overload here. I know we can do very odd things with the order of our verbs, but I think there's some systematicity in it, and it can be dealt with in this way. So in conclusion, I presented the complement raising HVG analysis of Dutch and German verb clusters, taking into account the most common instances of word order variation in a binary branching approach, and so which I think can deal with the most common constructions as a combination of complement raising and linearization constraints using the governor feature, and then which I think accounts for the variation that is attested in standard and some colloquial variants of Dutch and German verb clusters. The dialects show even other types of word order variation, but I think they should maybe get separate models to include all possibilities, at least for Dutch. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, just a little comment on the comparison you made. You compared Kattel with Barma and Van Noort, and said there are differences. But Barma and Van Noort had a totally flat verbal complex, right?
Yes.
Or even
yes.
The whole sentence was totally flat. And that's what Andreas Kattel is doing with the domain, so there's no difference.
You
have a very flat structure.
Yes, yeah, but I think Kattel, for the combination or for the feature sharing between the verbs and the non-verbal arguments, I think he uses the binary branching approach. So,
but
then for the word order, it's quite similar.
About the last thing, the Zwischenstellung, usually you cannot raise verbs out of the middle of verbal complexes, so it only works in, well, if this is an analysis, it only works there. So how do you block it in other situations?
What do you
mean? So if the word is behind können, how do you block that structure?
The same branching structure. Still working on the, so thanks for this comment, because I'm still working on the exact details, but I think it's an additional constraint on the constructions of the type head complement, so that in this case you can only have this type of construction if it is a raising construction, so if the complement occurs to the left, not on to the right, and that would actually be a constraint that is needed to model some variation in Dutch anyway, because there are varieties that only allow the participle in the middle, but some only allow the participle at the beginning of the, so that only allow the complement raising analysis, but not the regular one, so we need this constraint anyway.
Okay. Detmar had a solution for that, did you look at this? Detmar Moore?
Oh, okay, no, I'm not sure. Okay, look it up. Thanks.
from?
So, Alexander and I worked on some of these problems a long time ago, and I don't know German, I don't know Dutch, and I don't remember what we did. But I remember, what I remember is that having done all this, the challenging case was Swiss German, where you have all these properties of the verbs, and then the nouns start moving back, or the verbs start moving forward, but there's another constraint to remember, that a verb can't come in front of a noun that it takes as its overt argument. So, have you thought about, does that fit into?
Yes, I think that's stuff for another talk, but actually in my dissertation I dealt with this issue, so because I think I used an additional feature for that to make sure it had to do also the kind of non-verbal arguments that can appear within the cluster that is also only possible when they appear in front of the selecting verb. So
it works. Okay.
I hope so.
Yeah, just got a question maybe you can clarify. I didn't quite get, so you're doing actually basically the argument composition in the phrase structure rules instead of on the lexical heads, is that right?
So,
can you just walk me through, maybe now or offline, why it works? Would it work also with the lexical approach, or would it not work?
Well, the reason that the general argument raising for Dutch didn't work was because there was like. I need to think about some exact examples, but there were, for instance, problems if you would include raised complements on the argument structure list of object raising verbs. And so if you want to keep that lexical, that raised problem, so that was the reason to make it a phrasal constraint.
So you would say this stuff should actually work in Nuris Nakazawa style as well?
You mean the...
the Zwischenstellung. Would that work? I don't quite see why it shouldn't work with the lexical approach to argument composition rather than the phrase structure to argument composition.
I think because then the...
No, it does. So you agree with me it should work?
Yeah. May I add something here, maybe? For the lexical analysis, it will work out, technically speaking, but it doesn't interact all that well with the rest of the grammar. That's the problem with it. So raised subjects behave like proper arguments of the selecting verb, but raised complements do not behave like proper arguments of the selecting verb. And there are binding facts to show that. If you take your usual binding theory, then it works well with raised subject, but not with raised complements. And the same with passive, it works well with raised subjects, but not with raised complements. And that's why, if you have them on the valence list, you also have them in the argument structure list. I mean, that's the argument realization principle. Unless you start tinkering with the argument realization principle, you run into problems with respect to interaction with passive and binding. And then
I think on Philip have tinkered with it already, I think, in all the French critics, so they're not always identical, so...
Yeah, you can start tinkering with them. Yeah, it is not straightforward. You don't need the tinkering. And then the other thing is that this works for verb clustering, but it also works for apposition stranding, which we also have in Dutch. So apposition stranding is a case that can be handled within the same kind of complement raising mode as Liesbeth illustrated now for the verb cluster.
In Dutch, we actually even have adposition clusters, so clusters of adpositions that are left behind because the complement of the most embedded one has been raised out of the PP. So that's another reason for doing complement raising separately from subject raising. So subject raising is a lexical phenomenon, and complement raising is a phrasal phenomenon. That's what we conclude.
Okay, Stefan?
Yeah. Well, I think for German you need the complement raising, exactly because of passive. You have these remote passives, and I would do it like Bertolt suggested, saying, okay, if there's binding and there's a different, you know, different configuration needed, then you have a different list to do that, right? Or a structured RST list or something. Yes. So I wouldn't really want to be German and Dutch different on that syntactic thing. That really feels wrong. I mean, it felt wrong all the years to me. Sorry.
But if Dutch is a dialect of German, right?
That's what you said.
John, you have to help on this. Philippa Cook, she did analyze this with involving information structural consideration as well. It might be worth looking at Philippa Cook's stuff. And Mark Loudon has interesting data from Pennsylvania, Germany.
Other questions? Yeah. Anything?